molecular orbital theory. Told you before, small little topic in chemical bonding, but strangely has been accounting for problems every year. Every year in exams, you know, you have a question, at least one problem from MOT, where we tend to read this, we tend to learn it after knowing hybridization and valence bond theory, and even VACPR. Now, if you recall, in VACPR, depending upon the number of lone pairs and bond pairs, we are able to arrive at the expected and even the real structure of molecules. So, VACPR was of great help, you know, it could exactly tell me the position of the lone pairs, the structure of the molecule. So, we will first of all begin with this thought that why the need of MOT was felt. And yet again, maybe I have told you before, it was all about this molecule, oxygen. The molecule responsible for life on the planet, oxygen, diatomic. And you know, with all the information we have about chemical bonding, we could draw oxygen with two bond pairs and certainly two lone pairs over each oxygen atom. Fine, this is how the oxygen diatomic molecule should look like, with two bond pairs and two lone pairs over each oxygen atom. Now, whenever the electrons are paired up, bond pair or lone pair, the clockwise and the anti-clockwise spin, the clockwise and the anti-clockwise spin is going to get neutralized. And you know, in molecules where all the electrons are paired up, there is no net magnetic moment of the molecule. Alright, if all the electrons are paired up, because the clockwise and anti-clockwise moment is going to neutralize, if all the electrons are paired up, there is going to be no net magnetic moment with that molecule. And with all the electrons paired up, it is expected to be diamagnetic. Oxygen is expected to be diamagnetic. It was found to be paramagnetic. And this is how the entire story begins. Oxygen was found to be paramagnetic. Oxygen molecule was found to be paramagnetic, and this was baffling. Because you know, with all the electrons paired up, none of the theories read till this point could explain the paramagnetic nature of oxygen. Because you know, by all means, we are only able to know about the paired electrons here, either bond pairs or lone pairs. Now, when oxygen was found to be paramagnetic, I repeat, this happens to be the fact when the need of a better theory was felt, and this is how we happened to learn MOT. Now, into MOT, molecular orbital theory, it is going to start on a different premise altogether. So far, we have been dealing with atomic orbitals, and then we modified those atomic orbitals into hybrid orbitals, and then we considered the hybrid orbitals bearing bond pairs and lone pairs differently till VACPR. So, it was all about atomic orbitals till this point of time. In MOT, I repeat, we will begin with a different premise altogether. It is about molecular orbitals, where you know, the basic postulate is going to be, when we talk about atoms, we'll talk about atomic orbitals, but once we're talking about molecules, we'll need to know about molecular orbitals. So this transition is required to study molecular orbital theory, where you know, I repeat again, it rests on this common belief that in the formation of molecules, atomic orbitals also merge to form molecular orbitals. So, it is not only about hybridization or change in nature of the atomic orbitals, it is going to start a new kind of topic altogether. Instead of atomic orbitals, we will talk about molecular orbitals now. Now, how these atomic orbitals merge? What kind of atomic orbitals merge? We will have a few set of rules before going into this theory. That is going to be, and you can just take it down one by one. First of all, number of AOs merged will be equal to number of MOs produced. Number of atomic orbitals merged will be equal to number of molecular orbitals produced. Conservation of mass basically number of AOs merging would be equal to the number of MOs produced. Also, orbitals of equal energy, atomic orbitals of equal or comparable energy and radii are expected to merge. Fine. So, atomic orbitals of comparable energy and radii will merge to produce equal number of molecular orbitals. That's conservation of mass for us. Conservation of energy, in the sense, you know, this theory also takes into account, please be attentive, this theory also takes into account wave nature of electrons. So, you know, in the course of orbitals merging, having electrons, considering the wave nature of electrons, we have learnt about the dual nature of electrons before. It's based upon the wave nature. We realize whenever you have two waves which are completely in phase. Now, this will be superposition of waves which are completely in phase. It's going to result in a stronger wave. It's going to result in a stronger wave if these two merge. If these two merge, which are supposed to be completely in phase, this superposition would create a stronger wave with, you know, higher peaks and lower troughs. This will be called the constructive interference. This is called the constructive interference, where two orbitals completely in sync, completely in phase, merge with each other. And realize a merger of this kind, where one wave is of the kind such that, you know, it's merging with another wave, which looks completely antagonistic. You know, the peak of this is in sync with the trough of this. Now, these two completely merging would get neutralized. It would get neutralized. Yes or no? So, these are basics of waves which you'll pick up at some point of time. But it also takes into account this wave nature of electrons, where I know that a constructive interference would result in a stronger wave. And this will be called the destructive interference. A destructive interference would neutralize it. Alright. So, that's also taken into account while formulating the postulates of MOT. And what we learn is, two atomic orbitals merging to produce two molecular orbitals. See, you have two atomic orbitals merging to form two molecular orbitals. Right away, you know, I'm going to place them in an hierarchy. Because now I know about constructive and destructive interference, two AOs merging would give you two MOs. And the one which has come out of constructive interference would be called a bonding MO, would be called a bonding MO, and the other one will be called antibonding MO. So, two AOs producing two MOs, where one is bonding coming out of the constructive interference, alright, such that it's going to be more stable, it's going to be more stable, and in the energy profile, because it's more stable, it will have lesser energy. So, two AOs form two MOs, one which is more stable, bonding, having lesser energy, and another which is less stable, antibonding, having more energy. So, conservation of energy is also, you know, obeyed to a large extent. One basic difference between an atomic orbital and molecular orbital has to be the fact, you know, that when it comes to atomic orbitals, they need to be around just one nuclei. Yes or no? The nuclei of that atom. Whereas molecular orbitals are supposed to be polycentric. So that's another difference. AOs are supposed to be monocentric. Atomic orbitals are supposed to be monocentric around one nuclei. MOs are supposed to be polycentric. Fine. Now, that was another issue of argument, because, you know, every time in a covalent bond we talk about sharing of electrons, it becomes difficult to answer that these shared electrons are going to be around which nuclei. All right. So that argument is also taken care of. when we are dealing with molecular orbitals, it's going to be the common region around all the nuclei in the molecule. See, by orbitals, we always meant the region where the probability of finding the electron is maximum. So, an MO is going to be a common region, polycentric, or around all the nuclei in the molecule, where these electrons involved in bonding are going to stay. So, atomic orbitals were monocentric, whereas molecular orbitals are polycentric. Fine. The rule is, in an atom, all electrons are placed in atomic orbitals. In a molecule, the electrons should go into the molecular orbitals. The way in atoms, electrons go into atomic orbitals, in molecules, they should fill electrons into molecular orbitals. All the rules which we used to follow in filling electrons in atomic orbitals, I mean the Auerbach principle, Hund's rule, Pauli's exclusion principle, we are going to follow them while filling the molecular orbitals also. Alright. And the way we believed in electrons taking up orbitals from lower energy to higher energy, similarly, when it comes to molecules, electrons going into molecular orbitals, the rule would be, it will be filled from orbitals of lower energy to higher energy. From orbitals of lower energy to higher energy. And then, you know, the application of it, the effectiveness of this theory would need, first of all, its application. So, you know, right away, we would want to prepare a diagram which is called molecular orbital diagram, where we would at least want to know a merger of these orbitals is going to produce what kind of molecular orbitals and what is going to be the order in which they are going to be filled. So, we will stick to some very basic fundamentals we have learned before. Now, let this be the 1s orbital of two nuclei, in two nuclei approaching each other while forming a molecule. Two 1s orbital merging to form a bonding and an antibonding MO. A direct overlap is expected, and a direct communication between orbitals is called sigma, you know. So, we call it sigma 1s and sigma star 1s. This asterisk is going to denote, antibonding orbital. So, these two merge to form a sigma and a sigma star molecular orbital. Next in line would be the 2s orbitals, say forming the sigma 2s and the corresponding antibonding orbital. Fine. Atoms becoming molecules is eventually energetically feasible. You know, suppose that the molecules have a net energy lower than the sum of the energies possessed by the molecules. That's one factor driving molecule formation from atoms. So, you know, let me add another fact to it, that the bonding molecular orbital is going to be more stable, or is going to be lower than the average energy of the atomic orbitals, than the value by which this antibonding is higher. I mean, the sum of the bonding and antibonding is eventually going to be slightly less than the sum of the energies of atomic orbitals. Because I told you that the formation of molecular orbitals to atomic orbitals is going to be energetically feasible. Fine. So, this decrease is going to be slightly more than this increase. Fine. Now, after 2s, you have 2px, 2py and 2pv, you know, they are written together because px, py, pv happen to be degenerate. Degenerate means having same energy level. Alright. Now, expecting that the orbitals oriented along the x-axis have a direct overlap. I know I have tried to explain it before. If x, y and z, you know, if px, py and pz are oriented along the three mutually perpendicular coordinate axes, if this is x-axis, this is y-axis, and this is z-axis, let's again understand that once you have a direct overlap between two orbitals, say px, px overlapping, px, px having a direct overlap, py, py, and pz, pz cannot have a direct overlap. All right. So once you have a direct overlap of px, px orbitals, py, py, and pz, pz at most can have a lateral overlap. That's going to form the pi interaction. I hope I'm clear on this front. If px, px have a direct overlap, py, py, and pz, pz can have at most a lateral overlap, and this, you know, in not direct, lateral, partial interaction is called pi. But before that, px, px directly overlapping should result in a sigma 2px, and because it's going to be the most stable, you know, sigma is going to be more stable than pi. A direct overlap is going to be more effective than a partial overlap. That would mean that the bonding of a direct overlap will be more stable, yes or no? The bonding will be more stable and the antibonding will be least stable. So hereafter, you know, when we are dealing with degenerate orbitals, let's believe that this sigma 2px would be energetically more stable and the corresponding antibonding would be the least stable. This is my sigma star 2px. I repeat, if px, px have a direct overlap, py, py, and pz, pz at most can have partial overlap. And because direct is going to be more effective than partial, the corresponding sigma is going to be the most stable, and the corresponding sigma star antibonding is going to be the least stable. And the rest of them will have intermediate energy state. Py, py, and pz, pz. First of all, we know px, py, and pz are of equal energy. Out here, they're different because px is having a direct overlap and the other two are having partial overlap. But because the other two are having partial overlap, both of them are having partial overlap, don't you think this py, py interaction and pz, pz interaction would be energetically equivalent? Yes or no? Px is different because it had a direct overlap. So, you know, the bonding of py, py and pz, pz, the bonding of py, py and pz, pz should be degenerate, and so should be the corresponding antibonding. What I mean is, henceforth, while drawing the bonding and antibonding of py, py and pz, pz overlap, I would believe that because py and pz are having same kind of overlap, both pi, and certainly they are degenerate, the bonding of py, py, I'm going to call it py, py, and this is going to be pz, pz, will be degenerate, and the antibonding of these two, which is pi to py, pi to py, and pi to pz, pi to pz star, you know, the antibonding will also be degenerate. You know, if you keep these small little things in mind, if you approach this fundamentally, chances are you'll never have to mug up this this energy profile. Certainly, moving upwards, the energy of the orbitals is increasing. You know, the way we had an atomic orbitals with higher value of n and l, more away from the nuclei, the energy was more. Similarly here, moving upwards, the energy is increasing, and certainly while filling electrons, will fill electrons from sigma 1s, then sigma star 1s in this order. Alright, from lower energy to higher energy. Okay? I repeat, if you have this basic concept that px, px, if has a direct overlap, you know the sigma is going to be more stable, so it's going to lie below, and the corresponding antibonding will be at the top of these set of molecular orbitals. And then py, py and pz, pz undergoing identical interaction. Py, py ka bonding, which is pi to py, pi to py. You know why pi? Because it's not direct. And pi to pz, pi to pz, pi to py, pi to pz will be of the same energy, and their corresponding antibonding will also be of the same energy. Fair enough? Now our task would be, because we have been able to, you know, derive a set of molecular orbitals, and we also relate to the corresponding energies, will want to fill electrons in molecules with these rules. Let's begin with, you know, this permittent problem which we had before in oxygen. Atomic number of oxygen is 8. So oxygen molecule is going to have 16 electrons, and now we're going to fill electrons in the molecular orbitals. See what we do. Sigma 1s2, sigma star 1s2, sigma 2s2, sigma star 2s2, sigma 2px2, pi 2py2, pi 2pz2. See, the notations are identical to what we did in atomic orbitals. We know this number 2 in the superscript tells you the number of electrons, and before that, you know, we have given the molecular orbital. Like atomic orbitals, here also each orbital is going to have maximum 2 electrons with opposite spin. Fine. Now in the process, sigma 1s2, sigma star 1s2, sigma 2s2, reaching to this point, pi 2py2, pi 2pz2, we have been able to accommodate 14 electrons. If you count 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14. So till this point, we have accommodated 14 electrons. Alright. Now, these two are degenerate. We agreed these two are degenerate. Now, the rule says until and unless all orbitals degenerate have at least one electron, pairing can't start. Yes or no? This was Hund's rule. Until and unless there is one electron in all the degenerate orbitals, pairing can't start. So after 14, when I have to fill the 15th and 16th electron, they are going to go unpaired, pi star 2py1 and pi star 2pz1. Yes or no? And believe me, this is the only theory, this is the only phenomena by which we are able to trace unpaired electrons in oxygen. That's going to be the first and also, you know, the primary application of MOT. 16 electrons, if we go about filling the molecular orbitals in this defined order, till this point we have filled 14 electrons. Now because these two are degenerate, they'll get one electron each. These two electrons will not get paired up, and I repeat, this is the only theory which could predict and trace the presence of unpaired electrons in oxygen and now explaining its paramagnetism. Fair enough. Let's also know a few facts about MOT, which also, you know, relates to the understanding of the structure of the molecule. We have known the bonding and antibonding orbitals. We have also agreed that the bonding orbitals are going to be more stable, having lesser energy, and certainly if it's energetically more stable, the rule would be, the logic would be, and I have told you before, you know, the stability of a bond will depend upon, why do we say that a sigma bond is stronger than a pi bond? Because in a sigma bond, we have had a more effective overlap, yes or no? We've had a more effective overlap. And the rule is, suppose the two atoms or any two atoms which are bonded to each other, their nuclei got to repel. Their nuclei got to repel because nuclei will be positively charged. Yes or no? Any bond between two nuclei, any bond between two atoms, these two nuclei would always repel because they are positive both. And then the stability of the bond. See, again, they are linked because they have common electron density, which we call covalent bond. Now, certainly, more of this density, if there is more electron density, it acts as an adhesive before, I told you. It acts as an adhesive. If you have more electron density between two nuclei, you know, it's going to decrease the repulsion between the two nuclei. Yes or no? So, this is where a more effective overlap or more electron density between the two nuclei. Let me tell you this way, orbitals eventually are going to be the region where the probability of finding electrons is maximum. We've also dealt with the wave nature. We have tried to figure out It could be a constructive or destructive interference. And then after more detailed and, you know, advanced study, we would get to know that the electrons going in bonding orbitals, please be attentive, the electrons going in bonding orbitals would go towards strengthening the bond. The electrons going into bonding orbitals, effectively they're going to increase more electron density between the two nuclei. All right, and more electron density between two nuclei would mean stronger association, would mean a stronger bond. So it goes like the following: electrons going into bonding orbitals, electrons going into bonding orbitals will strengthen the bond, and electrons going into antibonding orbitals are going to weaken the bond. I repeat, it's all about electron density between the nuclei, and orbitals always happen to be the region where the probability of finding the electron is more or less. Fine. Now, the rule is more electrons in bonding orbitals, stronger bond; more electrons in antibonding orbitals, weaker bond. And eventually we derive a term, a parameter, which is called bond order. And this is supposed to be mathematically half the number of electrons going into bonding orbitals. NB will mean the number of electrons going into bonding orbitals, minus NAB, where AB would stand for antibonding. So NB minus NAB, NB minus NAB is like the difference of electrons, is the difference of electrons going into bonding and antibonding orbitals. I told you those going into bonding would strengthen it, those going into antibonding would weaken it, and mathematically half of the difference would give you the bond order. Half of the difference would give you the bond order. I've told you before, mathematically it could have different values, but it's supposed to be, this term bond order is supposed to be a measure of the strength of the bond. Bond order is supposed to be a measure of the strength of the bond. So more bond order would mean a stronger bond. I repeat, bond order is supposed to be a measure of the strength of the bond. Suddenly you can figure out, more electrons going into bonding is going to increase the bond order, more electrons going into antibonding are going to decrease the bond order. So eventually it gives you a measure of the strength of the bond. And incidentally, every time it's a whole number, every time it's a whole number, it's an integer, it's going to also tell you the number of bonds. It has to be taken as, because we'll see fractional bond orders also. We'll see fractional bond orders. So right away, let's understand, bond order is not equal to the number of bonds. You know, it's actually a measure of the strength between the measure of the strength of the bond. And every time it's an integer, bond order 1 would mean it's a single bond, bond order 2 would mean it's a double bond, and so and so. Fine. Now what you can see here is, out of these 16 electrons, 10 would have gone into bonding orbitals. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. See, out of 16 electrons, 10 have gone into bonding, and those 6 have gone into antibonding orbitals. Now bond order is 2, and it also explains double bond between oxygen atoms. It also explains this double bond between oxygen atoms. So, you know, using MOT, first of all, and that's going to be more important, we'll be able to predict, we'll be able to predict and explain the magnetic behavior of molecules and species. So, you know, this tells you that oxygen has to be paramagnetic. Only this theory I told you would reveal presence of unpaired electrons here. So it's going to disclose the magnetic behavior of the species, predict the magnetic behavior of the species. Also, it could tell you the bond order. You could use this to find the bond order. Another very interesting application, very interesting illustration is about, say, a possible helium molecule. A possible helium molecule Now, a possible helium molecule would have had, say, 2 helium atoms. Fine. And the total count of electrons would have been 4. In a possible helium molecule,